Hello students, welcome to this program. Today we will discuss an important topic, that is motivation in organizations. This is one of the topics in organizational behavior of MSc Psychology second year. As all of you know students, the motivation has different theories. There are different theories of motivation which are related to organizations, and the motivation theories have been classified into say content theories and also process theories. Under content theories, there are many theories. For example, say Maslow's hierarchy of needs theory and the Herzberg's two-factor theory and ERG theory of Adler-Fehr. That like this, there are many theories. They are based on need. And there are also process theories. One is equity theory of Adams, and another theory is the expectancy theory that is developed by Porter and Lawler, and Rumer is also another person who is associated with the expectancy theory. Today we will be discussing only three theories. Though there are many theories which are very related to organizations, we will be discussing three selected theories. One such theory is Maslow's theory, which is based on needs, and another theory is two-factor theory of Herzberg. That is a two theory, and another last one is the Porter theory. Before we discuss this, we will also discuss and also explain the meaning and definitions of motivation. To discuss all these aspects, we have with us an expert in organizational behavior. She is Dr. Viraja Rao. She is assistant professor in Department of Psychology, Usmani University. To start with, now we will discuss, we will try to know the meaning and definition of motivation. Dr. Viraja, will you please throw light on the meaning and definitions of motivation?
So, motivation refers to an inner driving force. It's an inner striving condition which activates an individual into action and continues a person in the course of action enthusiastically. Another important thing is motivation consists of three very important interacting elements, that is need, drives and incentives. So, here needs are created whenever there is a physiological or psychological imbalance. So, for example, a need exists when cells in the body are deprived of food or water, or when the personality is deprived of important, you know, people who serve as friends or relatives or companions. Another important element of motivation is drive. This is almost like, you know, heart of the motivational process. A drive is a deficiency with direction. So, physiological and psychological drives are action oriented and provide an energizing thrust towards reaching an incentive. Now, for example, need for food or water are translated into hunger and thirst drives, and the need for friends becomes a drive for affiliation. So, another important element is incentive. This is almost at the end of the motivation cycle, we can say, and it is said to alleviate again need and drive only. And need here, incentive reduces or cut off the drive. For example, eating food, having water or drinking water, or obtaining friends will tend to restore the balance, right? So, food, water, friends, they can be considered as incentives. Yeah. So, and there are so many, you know, different motives we can say. So, for example, primary motives. Primary motives are primary motives or drives. They are called as even drives also. So, primary motives are unlearned physiologically based. For example, food, water, sleep, avoidance of pain, sex, they are considered as primary motives, and as the human society is developing, these primary motives gave way to secondary, yes, you know, drives. So these are, you know, most important, especially when it comes to organizations. These are the secondary motives which are important. And other motives are intrinsic motives, extrinsic motives, other than primary motives and secondary motives. These are very important for us to understand these, you know, different motives before entering into organizational behavior, and more so with the motivational theories of organization. And as we are discussing the theories of motivation, there are different types of theories here. They start with content theories, process theories, and other, you know, contemporary theories. As
now you explained the meaning of motivation, and also you said there are two types of motives, that is primary and secondary. And the primary is innate and the secondary is learned. And the motivation, it has a different function. You also said it has a directional function. It means, when there are different choices or options or alternatives, you will be choosing one. That means because of your motivated to choose one. That means that motivation has one function of direction. And the motivation also has another function or a dimension or other indicator is intensity of motivation. Intensity is how much effort a person puts in. That is the intensity function. And there is also, as you said, another function, that is persistency. How long a person stays with the goal attainment in spite of the obstacles. There will be several obstacles when the two for the attainment of a goal. But how much it refers to, that the persistence refers to continued effort in spite of obstacles. And there is also another function, that is latency. Where it shows the gap between the idea or the desire and the action initiated. The gap, how much time a person takes to initiate an action. So that that function is also there. So that what I am trying to say here is the motivation has different functions or different dimensions or different indications. One is, as I said earlier, less choice is one, and the intensity, persistency,
consistency,
and what's consistency. These are the things, aspects of the thing which are related to the motivation. And theories, there are different theories. One is the popular and most popular theory is developed by Maslow. He is a humanist psychologist. That theory is very popular, and that is also applicable to organizations. Will you please throw light on the Maslow's theory of motivation in relation to organizations?
So, Abraham Maslow, from humanistic psychology with clinical experience, he thought that a person's motivational needs could be arranged in a hierarchical manner. In essence, once a given level of need is satisfied, it no longer serves to motivate. The next higher level of need has to be motivated or activated in order to motivate an individual. So, Maslow, he identified five levels in his need hierarchy. The first level is physiological needs, followed by safety needs, then love needs, esteem needs, followed by self-actualization needs. So, once these basic needs, at physiological needs, they are more like, you know, primary needs as it is mentioned. So, once these basic needs are satisfied, they no longer motivate. For example, a starving person will strive for a carrot. Once the carrot is, you know, filling his stomach, he may not actually, you know, get motivated to have another carrot. So, this is the basic physiological need. Next is safety needs. This second level of need is roughly equivalent to the security level. So, Maslow stressed that emotional as well as physical safety, the whole organism may become a safety seeking mechanism. Once the safety needs are satisfied, they no longer motivate. Next are love needs. These are the intermediate level of needs, and they loosely correspond to the affection, affiliation needs. So, it is more like, you know, belongingness or social needs. Next, esteem needs and self-actualization needs are the growth needs. The other three are the deficiency needs, whereas esteem needs and self-actualizations are related to the growth needs here. So, esteem level represents the higher needs of human beings. So, esteem level contains self-esteem, esteem from others, related to achievement, power, status, satisfaction, these aspects. Need for self-actualization has the culmination of all the lower levels as well as intermediate and higher level of needs. And here, higher needs are something like, you know, becoming a self-actualized person, self-fulfilling person. They have realized their potential as human being. So, this is the highest level of, you know, human needs. In fact, when we apply this to workplace, the basic needs are very much related to the pay, rewards, incentives. These are the basic level, you know, needs here. So, once they are satisfied, they will be motivated with regard to security level needs. They are related to seniority plans, union, trade union needs and all that, health insurance, employee assistance plans and severance pay, pension, etc. And the next intermediate level of needs that are social needs are formal, informal, group, interpersonal relations, team relations, these are the needs. Next are esteem needs. They come with, you know, titles, status symbols, promotions, banquets, etc. And when it comes to self-actualization needs, they are very much related to personal growth, realization of potential, etc. So, this is the hierarchy of needs with regard to working organizations. Now, one thing is they are very applicable. In fact, many other hierarchy of needs or paradigms are developed based on Maslow hierarchy of needs, but there is very limited research conducted on this. And not only that, this is the wisest theory that is, you know, like applied to the present conditions, we can say. One important thing is gratifying the highest level of need, that is self-actualizing need, it may actually, you know, increase or motivate a person to, you know, like ask for more. It's something like that. And the structure he gives from basic needs to the self-actualization needs, it may not go in the same structural way. So, this is also another limitation. But when we apply it to the, you know, the present organization, say for example, under some critical conditions, when the organization or the management is seeking for, you know, terminations, sudden layoffs, when those people who are still with the organizations, if they are given the basic pay and certain, you know, emotional needs satisfied, may again, you know, make them develop a kind of citizenship behavior, you know, in employees. So, these are applicable even in the present conditions, but with certain limitations, you know, that it can be applied to the present conditions as well.
You said that self-actualization is the highest level of need, and the Maslow said very few people reach that level of self-actualization, because the person has to satisfy the lower level needs. Here, the what the companies or the management or the organizations have to do to make the people to realize their potential to the fullest extent. So, the theory suggests, as you said that theory suggests there should be necessary facilities or opportunities in the company or in the organizations, which helps the employees to satisfy or fulfill their lower level needs, which are below the self-actualization, so that you will work hard and you will contribute to the higher level, so that company productivity also increased. So, that is about the theory of Maslow. And another important theory is two-factor theory. Two-factor theory that Edgeworth, that theory covers two factors. That is hygiene factors and also motivational factors.
Yes.
So, what do you mean by this hygiene factors or motivational factors which are proposed by the Edgeworth?
So, before entering into hygiene factors and motivating factors, here we need to discuss a little about Hertzberg. Yes, he is very much influenced by Maslow's theory, but again, you know, he comes, you know, a little more towards the practice. And here, He has conducted research on around 2000 accountants based on two important assessments. And one important assessment is, I mean, the data was collected based on two questions. So, here one question was, when did you feel particularly good about your job? In simple, you know, sentence, what turned you on? Another question was, when did you feel exceptionally bad about your job? That is, what turned you off? So, these were the two questions, and the answers are based on this job content and job context. So, the reported good feelings were generally associated with the job experiences or job content. For example, if an employee was provided with the new computer technology, say, or a new, you know, challenging experience or new challenging job task, they were very satisfied, they were very happy. When it comes to the reported bad feelings, they were generally associated with the surrounding working conditions, say, or monotonous job, routine record work, etc. So, the job satisfiers were related to the job content, whereas dissatisfiers were related to the job context. So, here Herzberg labeled the satisfiers as motivators or motivating factors, and dissatisfiers were related to the hygiene factors. Here, the hygiene refers to more or less with the health field, right? So, these are the factors which could be preventive. That means, hygiene factors can be prevented. In Herzberg theory, the hygiene factors are those that prevent dissatisfaction. Taken together, the motivators and the hygiene factors have become to known as Herzberg's two-factor theory. And the general hygiene factors here, we can discuss them as company policies and administration, supervision, technical aspect, salary, interpersonal relations, supervisors, management, working conditions, etc. When it comes to motivators, they are like achievement, recognition, work itself, responsibility, advancement, etc. So, here we need to talk about one important thing. Hygiene factors are preventive, and they are very much, you know, environmental in nature, and they are roughly equivalent to Maslow's primary needs. And these hygiene factors prevent dissatisfaction if they are taken care of, right? And they do not lead to satisfaction. And hygiene factors bring motivation up to a theoretical zero level and are a necessary flaw to prevent dissatisfaction, and they serve as a platform or taken off point for motivation. By themselves, hygiene factors can never become or never motivate. Only the motivators can motivate the employees at the job, but if the dissatisfiers are not prevented, they may again become biggest hurdle in the process of getting motivated. So, here the challenging jobs or new technology or anything, you know, where the employees can use their discrepancy, all these can become the motivators, but the general working conditions, etcetera, they can become the hygiene factors too. So, here these are the two important factors that must be understood from Herzberg two-factor theory. But again, there is a very small, you know, limitation over here, because he somehow oversimplifies the complexities of work motivation.
And the another important theory that we need to discuss is expectancy theory, that is developed by Porter and Lawler. And this theory, it focuses on three important concepts. One is effort, and another one is performance, and there is a reward, and other fourth one is satisfaction. And we have to discuss the relationship between the effort and performance, and the performance and reward and satisfaction. Will you please throw light on these different concepts of the theory?
The important elements here, the first and foremost element to be understood in Porter and Lawler's expectancy theory is effort. Now, what is effort? Effort refers to the amount of energy exerted by a person on a job. Now, effort is influenced by value of reward and perceived effort reward probability. The value of reward and perceived effort reward probability, and what is value of reward of valence, the outcome of a particular behavior. Effort put by an individual has a specific valence, that is the motivating power of value. That means what the person is expecting out of his performance or effort, is the effort is the desired effort, and the desired effort whatever that person is showing has the same, you know, the reward or the value of the reward, is it matching with what is expected by the employee. So all these aspects must be somewhere matched, then only the person is going to feel satisfied. And again, one more important thing is the performance is the desired, you know, performance, right? Is it matching with his abilities? And here we need to discuss about the second important, you know, aspect, that is perceived effort and reward probability. This refers to the individual perception of the probability that different rewards depend upon different degrees of effort. Now, value for reward for a person and his perception of effort reward probability will determine the amount of efforts that he will put. This is the most important aspect to be understood in Porter and Lawless. Now, what is performance? Effort definitely leads to performance, but both may not be equal. The desired performance may not equal the actual effort that is put in by the employee here. So, performance is very much determined by the amount of effort and the ability plus role perception. If they are not clear about their, you know, role perception, say, then it may lead to, you know, wrong performance, right? And the rewards, again, this another element to be understood. Performance can lead to two types of rewards. One is intrinsic reward and the other one is extrinsic, right? Intrinsic is something comes from within. Extrinsic is outside the
person.
Now, here again the satisfaction is another important aspect. The extent to which the actual rewards fall short and the individual's perceived equitable rewards, that determines the degree of satisfaction. What I am expecting out of my work, is it matching with the actual reward given by the organization? They should match somewhere. Match. Otherwise, I may not be satisfied, right? That's exactly what it means. That means satisfaction is partly determined by rewards as well as the performance. Is my performance, again, you know, is it relating to the desired performance? Then only it leads to, again, you know, satisfaction.
Thank you, madam. You have discussed and thrown light on different aspects of motivational theories that are applicable to organizations. We have discussed three important theories. There is one is Maslow's, and there is Edgeworth's two-factor theory, and also Porter and Lawler expectancy theory. Thank you, Dr. Veerasamy.